Okay, I'm going to go straight ahead and talk about family planning. We are way behind schedule, sorry for that. So we usually talk about family planning as something some people think that is something that you're not supposed to speak about or talk about in quarters of, especially for men. Family planning is not just for women. Family planning is something extensive. It's a way of life nowadays. Because you look at family planning as something that is going to help you manage your life. I want children. I'm a man. I want children. But how do I bring beings into this world without having a proper plan? It's something that all of us should ask ourselves. Not just a woman. It's both the man and the woman. When you have an element of inclusivity of both the male gender and the female gender, you are able to achieve more. It's not, let's not talk about family planning as something for the woman only. So without further ado, I'm going to talk about the methods of family planning or the types of family planning. There are several types of family planning. Number one, we have the hormonal. And this hormonal, most people know about the hormonal contraceptives. There is the implants, the ones that you actually put under the skin. There is the IUDs. IUDs are intrauterine devices. So we have both hormonal and non-hormonal. So in this instance, we are talking about the hormonal types. We have patches, we have pills, and we also have injectables. And under the injectables, we have 1 month, we have 3 months, and even 2 months. So it will depend on each circumstance. Please remember, you have to be assessed for you to be told if you need to use hormonal or not. You need to seek medical advice before you take any, especially for the hormonal family planning. The other things is non-hormonal. In non-hormonal, we have barrier methods, which are the condoms, the diaphragms, etc. Then we have the fertility awareness and what we call safe days. So somebody should know when they are safe. And this is especially for both male and females. If you're married, you have to ensure that you know your partner's safe days, because it's a collective effort. It's not one-sided. Then we have the other one, which is withdrawal. And this is especially for men. You're supposed to know when to withdraw. And remember, these methods are not 100%. They have to be used together with another method to be able to be effective. Then the last one is abstinence. Abstinence, especially for young people or teenagers, we teach them abstinence. It's a method of them taking control of their lives. The other one, the other type of family planning is the permanent method. And for the permanent method, you realize that these are mostly irreversible. We've not gotten a way to reverse them. So I wouldn't say they are reversible in some quarters. It's a controversial type of thing. So I wouldn't say it's reversible. So for now, it's a permanent thing. When you have a vasectomy, so for that is for men, or a tubal ligation or bilateral tubal ligation. These are the methods that we have currently, and you're able to access them in any of the facilities in Kenya. Several facilities are able to, you're able to get this information. So anytime that you need to plan your family, you need to talk to a practitioner who's able to advise you properly. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Yvonne to proceed with the presentation. Yvonne?
Thank you very much, Francis. So I'm going, we are going to learn more about family planning. So you can go to the next slide. So we are going first to know the objective of this webinar today. So the first objective that you need to know and you need to understand after finishing this webinar, the first one is to gain knowledge and understanding on various types of family planning. So as we have been told several family planning that they're there, but you're going to learn each and every method, how it is used and how you're supposed to do it. So the next objective is the importance of family planning methods. So in the daily lives of a person who is married or a couple, so there are those important factors why we are using this family planning and why should we use this. So the next slide, please. So for the next thing, we have to know what is family planning. So I'm going to define what is family planning on the easiest way possible. So family planning is the ability of a woman or a couple to decide when to have a child or children, how many, and at what interval. So in this, it helps in a person or a family child facing their children. And in this, they also plan their future better by making their finances well, and also anything that does with the family lives of their children can grow well with then better nutritional value because they'll have all the time to take care of them. So in family planning, this is mostly for people who are sexually active, and this usually involves several types of contraceptions and techniques to control the timing for reproduction. I've talked about the child spacing. So we are going to talk about the importance of family planning. So the first importance of family planning is, so the first importance of family planning, number one, it helps the couples to avoid unintended pregnancies. By avoiding unintended pregnancies, it also reduces the number of abortions, even in the number of sexually active people in the world. So number two, it reduces the spread of sexually transmitted diseases. And in this, use of the dual protection, like use of condoms, usually help people to prevent issues like HIV, gonorrhea, syphilis. So it reduces the spread of sexually transmitted diseases. The third importance of family planning is the reduction of infertility by addressing the problem of STDs. So if you prevent the sexually transmitted diseases like syphilis usually causes a secondary infertility. So by preventing these sexually transmitted diseases, it also helps us in reducing the rate of infertility in the population. So there are some points to note on this. So most of the elements are considered by women and men or couples at any given point of their lives when choosing the appropriate contraceptive methods. So these elements are safety. This is the safetiness of that family planning method they need to use. The effectiveness, this is the rate of failure. If it has a high chance of failure rate, someone may decide to choose a different type of family planning. Availability is where you can get the type of family planning readily. And you can find in the most population, like in our country, most of the people take hormonal-based family planning methods because those are the ones that are available to them and they can access it at maybe affordable choice price, and also acceptability in that a couple may decide to take different family planning depending on one spouse, on how if one spouse decides to take this family planning, they can accept or deny them to use. So there are some things that we talk about family planning, something like voluntary informed choice. This is where you get to a clinic. You are told about all family planning methods that are available, and you decide by yourself on what family planning method that you're going to take without any biasness by the service provider that is going to give you the service. So voluntary informed choice of the contraceptive method is essential in guiding the principles and contraceptive counseling where applicable. It may be an important contributor in the successiveness use of the contraceptive methods. So in a case where the patient needs the family planning method, they are advised accordingly to what family planning they are supposed to take and what intervals they are supposed to take. Like we say, for example, pills. They are given ways on how to take them, what time to take them. So when you get that counseling, you get the best way possible to make a decision on what to use. So we also talk about dual protection. Dual protection is the simultaneous, you protect yourself from two things. So the dual protection, you prevent from sexually transmitted diseases, and you also protect yourself from unwanted pregnancies. So is everyone seeing the slides?
No, we're not able to see the slides now.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, go ahead.
So we were on the point of, So we have talked about voluntary informed choice of contraception methods. That is the essential guiding principle in contraceptive use. So we have also talked about dual protection, that is simultaneous risk of choosing a method that will protect you from a risk of HIV and other STIs, and maybe pregnancy. So the next thing we are going to talk about, I'm going to start the family planning methods, and I'm going to start with intrauterine device. We have two types of intrauterine devices. We have one that is hormonal, and we have one that is non-hormonal. So there is the levoresterone intrauterine device. This one is a small T-shaped device. It just looks like the copper tin. It's placed by the in the uterus by the doctor. It has an amount of progesterone that usually is released in the uterine walls every day to keep you from getting pregnant. So we have different versions of the hormonal-based intrauterine device, and it ranges from 3 to 6 years, depending on the device, in keeping one from getting pregnant. So we have an example that is in the market, that is Mirena, and the failure rate is usually 0.1 to 0.4. So we have Copatin triuterine device. This one is a small device that is in the form of a T. You can see on the picture down below. And the doctor places it inside the uterus to prevent pregnancy. So we have different types of the copper T, so they can stay up to 10 years. So we have some examples of the family planning of the copper T that we have in the market. We have the copper T that has 380 of the copper. We have another version that is called a multi-load that has 375 of the copper. That one stays in the, it prevents one from getting pregnant up to 5 years. We have one that is 250 copper, and it prevents one from getting pregnant, that is 3 years. And the failure rate is about 0.8. So basically, the copper intrauterine device does not affect any, the copper one does not have hormones, so it doesn't change your normal routine, your body weight, your blood pressure. So it's a safe method of family planning method, and your menses usually come on a daily basis. on a no on a monthly basis. Sorry about that. So you can see a picture there down there. That's how it looks like. So the next method of family planning I'm going to talk about is implants. Implants are usually a rod, like down there you can see. So there are two types of implants in the market. There is Implano and Jadel. So basically these implants are usually inserted in a woman's upper arm, preferably the dormant hand that is not working. And in the Implano, it is usually put one rod. And this one usually takes a person up to 3 years. And the Jadel usually has two rods and it's placed under the skin in a form of a V. And it stays in the body up to 5 years use. So in this, the typical failure rate is 0.1. So this one is a hormonal version of family planning. Different people get different side effects. Some people may add weight because of the hormones. Some may stay on their normal weight. Some may reduce their weight and some may also have heavy bleeding. Some may have the normal bleeding and some may also have no bleeding at all. So it depends on their body. So you are not the same as your friend. So do not be discouraged by a person saying that I use this method, it affected my friend this way. So you should try it yourself before making a decision that is not good for you. So we are going to the next slide. I'm going to talk about injectables. Injectables, these are injections or shots that a woman gets and it usually contain hormones. So basically when a patient comes to the facility, they are given the service of injectables. So they can be injected on their arm, they can be injected on their buttocks, and depending on which type of family planning that they need. So there are different types of family planning. So the Norgyno is a 1 month injection and it is given after every 4 weeks, that is a month. We have the Nordesterone. It usually contains a hormone called Nordesterone and it usually takes 1 up to 2 months after the injection, that is 8 weeks. So we also have Depo-Provela. It usually takes 1 up to 13 weeks after injection. And we have a new version of the injectable that is called Cyanopress. Cyanopress is usually given subcutaneous and you can do it from the comfort of your home after you purchase the medication. And it gives you up to 3 months of use. So the difference between the Depo-Provela and Cyanopress is that Cyanopress has the same hormone as the Depo-Provela, but it has low content of the hormone. So it usually comes in a 0.5 mil a tube that is usually has a needle in it and you can inject it from the comfort of your home. But the Depo-Provela, you have to come to the facility to take it and it's usually 1 mil. So the failure rate of injectables is about 4%. So that's still a small number. So we have another type of contraception that is oral contraception. So we usually have two types and the first type is combined oral pills. So this has two hormones. It has estrogen and it has progesterone. So this one preferably after coming to the hospital, you are prescribed by a doctor that pill and you start it the same day. And the same day that you're in the hospital. Preferably, we prefer clients coming to the facility on their periods, meaning that they are not pregnant. So that we have in the hormonal-based family planning method, we have around 7 days before the drug is effective in the body. So when you have your period and you come and start the medication then, by the seventh day, maybe after your period, you have the increased safety of that drug when you're using it. So we usually tell clients, if you take the medication at 7 a.m., remember tomorrow you have to take it at 7 a.m. Some people may forget to take it, but we tell them to take it as soon as they remember. So this is not for anyone that forgets easily. And we usually have some criteria of how we see best for someone to using this family planning. So if you are older than 35 and you are smoking, and if you have history of blood clots of cancer, we advise you not to take this pill because it can make the condition worse. So we have some examples in the market. Some people may know of Femiplan, Microgyno. I can name a few like Yasmin. Those are types of family planning that are combined oral pills. And the failure rate of this is about 7%. So we have the progesterone-only pill. That's the second type of the oral contraceptive. So the progesterone-only pill is usually contain progesterone only. That's an hormone. And most of the people may call it the mini pill. So this one is also prescribed by the doctor. And you're supposed also to take it the same time each day. So for people who have issues like maybe, this is mostly prescribed for people who have high blood pressure that is not that is well controlled, you can take this. You can also take this when you are breastfeeding. So people who are breastfeeding are not advised to take combined oral pills. So the best option on this, they take the progesterone only pills. So the examples in the market, currently we have Microlut, and the failure rate of this also is 7%. So you can see they work. It's not 100%, remember that. So we have another version of hormonal-based family planning. So we have a patch. So a patch is, it looks like an elastoplast, but a bigger version. As you can see on the screen there, it's a bit smaller and it has a thin lining. So for the patch, you can wear it on the lower abdomen. You can place it on your buttock or in the upper part of the body, but do not place it on your breast. So this is also prescribed by the doctor and it releases the progesterone and estrogen in the bloodstream. So ideally, this is you usually start it when you're on your period. And again, it comes in three pieces. So each and every week, you need to change a new patch. So during the fourth week, you don't need to wear the patch. So that's when you can expect maybe the next week you're starting your period. So an example in the market currently is called Evra. And also the failure rate is about 7% in the population. So we can go next. So we also have another version of family planning that is also hormonal, and we call it the hormonal vaginal contraceptive ring. So this one is also a hormone based, but it looks like a ring, just as you can see. And it's usually placed in your vagina, and then you have to change it every 3 weeks. So you take it out as a week before your period, and usually change it after you usually wear it after your period. So basically this ring has progesterone and estrogen that is released in your body, in your vagina. So the failure rate also, this one has 7% failure rate. So I'm going to talk about different type of family planning. And now we are going to talk about barrier method. So barrier, it means this thing is, it's obstructing the sperm from getting inside. So we have different types of barrier methods. So I'm going to start with the first one that is called a male condom. A male condom is a rubber sheet worn by a man over the penis before sexual intercourse. And this condom usually keeps the sperm from getting into the woman's body. So mostly we have the latex condom and usually helps in preventing pregnancy, HIV, and also STIs. So this is one of the methods that usually have the dual protection. So in the previous times, the condoms were made out of lambskin, but the newer version, they are made of the synthetic material, rather than latex, but they are still the latex one in the market. So they usually prevent pregnancy, as I've said before, and they also prevent you from getting STDs, including HIV. And basically, this one, the failure rate is 13%. And remember, condoms cannot be reused. These are male condoms. When you buy them, you have to check the expiry date to make sure that it's okay for you not to use it the wrong way. And you must have worn the condom the right way. Otherwise, it is going to break. The area where it has the air, you have to make sure it's the top part. So some people may prefer using some lubricants. So KY jelly and water-based lubricants, they are good. But if you use oil-based lubricants such as massage oil or baby oil, petroleum jellies on the latex condom, they usually weaken the condom. And this one can have a repercussion like them breaking and maybe not having what you decided, the effect that you decided to prevent pregnancy when it breaks. So some examples in the market, we have Durex. Most of you know of this. We have Sure. This is a government issued one. And we have a Trust condom also. So we go on to the next type of barrier method. This is the female condom. So this one is usually worn by a woman, and it also prevents the sperm from getting to the body. So basically, the female condom looks, it's usually bigger than the male condom. It has two rings. So the first ring is a bit harder than the other one, because it has to help you inserting the female condom, because this female condom is usually inserted in a woman's vagina. So basically, you can insert it up to 8 hours before sex, and the failure rate is about 21, because mwanaume anezenda kando, the man can enter you. As a lady, you are supposed to make sure your man is inside the condom. Otherwise, he may get outside, and you will not have the desired effect that you wanted. And it also has a dual protection in that it helps one from prevention from STDs and also pregnancy. So we are going on with the barrier methods. So we have another type of barrier method that is called the spermicide. The spermicide, as the name says, this kills the sperm. And they come in different versions. We have the form. We have ones that are in gel form. We have some that are in cream. Some are in film. Some are in suppository, that is in tablet form. And these ones are usually placed in the vagina just like an hour before intercourse, and can be left up to 8 hours after sex. So in addition to this, the spermicide, the male condom, diaphragm, and cervical cap, they can also be purchased over the counter. So, and the failure rate is usually 21%. So we have another version of the barrier method. We have the diaphragm and the sponge. So each method, like we have talked about, this is also a barrier method. So a diaphragm looks like what we have down there. This one is usually also placed in the vagina, and it usually covers the cervix. The cervix is the entrance to the uterus in layman's language. Let me use that. And this one usually protects the sperm from entering. It looks like a shallow cap. And this one is usually, most of them are made of silicone, and they can be placed before sex. And you can also apply some spermicide just to kill the sperms when you're placing it. So here you can have a visit to the doctor and have them fit in your body, so that we can know the best size for you, because we are not the same. Like if we are tall and short, so this one is placed in different sizes depending on someone's size. And the failure rate here is usually 17%. So we also have another barrier method called a sponge. So it usually contains spermicide. So in this, it has the spermicide already placed in, and it's also put on the vagina, and it is fitted over the cervix. As I said, the cervix is the doorway to the uterus. So this one can work up to 24 hours, and it can last up in the vagina up to 6 hours after the last act of intercourse. So every time you use it, you have to discard it. So the failure rate here is 14%. In ladies who have never had children before, and 27% in people who have had babies before. So you can see this failure rate is it's a little bit high. So you may find currently in the market, they are not available anymore because of the risk, the increased risk of HIV. So this why we withdrew from the market. So we have another method The withdrawal method is usually based as a natural family planning method. So a withdrawal method is basically a man pulling his penis out of a woman's vagina before ejaculation of the sperm occurs. So this is also called in other words, it's also called coitus interruptus, because you interrupt sex, because when the man is ejaculating, when he has this, he pours the sperm to the vagina, the sperm can lead to fertilization. So when it withdraws the sperm from the vagina, the woman does not get pregnant. But in this method, the effectiveness depends on the user. Not everybody will do this the right way. So you may get the failure rate being very high in people who don't know how to use the withdrawal method. So we have some other family planning methods. So we are going to talk about the fertility awareness. So fertility awareness basically is some cycle. So if you know your monthly cycle, you can know your safe days. These safe days are, we call safe days the days that you cannot get pregnant. And in a woman who is having a 28-day cycle, they usually have at least 9 days in their month that they are not safe, they can conceive. So if you have a regular, this is usually for people who have regular cycles. And as I've said, there are about 9 days of the fertile days in each month. So some things that are modern right now, some people are using the phone mobile apps that they are using for to monitor their cycle. And it usually shows someone when this, the mobile apps usually show you when you can conceive, and they tell you to use maybe another method like a condom. So we also have cycle beats. And in the past years, people used also calendar. And some people also monitor their body temperatures. So when your temperature is slightly high, 2 degrees, you know you are ovulating. You need either to not to have sex, or you use another method of family planning like condoms during that period. So you can also check your cervical mucus. So during ovulation, your cervical mucus tends to be a little bit more, and it's a bit thin than the normal one. So some people also use ovulation kits. And in this, they usually check with their hormones. So we also have the thermometer. Here we have talked about people checking their body temperatures in the morning. If it's slightly 2 degrees, you know that you are ovulating. So it also has a failure rate at least 2 to 23%, depending on the person who is using this method. So we have another method that is on the natural family planning method. And in here we have the lactational amenorrhea. So lactational amenorrhea is for people who are breastfeeding. So in this, it's used by people who have recently had a baby and they are currently breastfeeding. So it can be used at birth when these conditions are met. So these are the three conditions that need to be met so that you can know that when you use this method, you are good. So the first method is amenorrhea. Amenorrhea means you don't have any menstrual period in every monthly cycle. Some people may miss their period after delivery and can last up to a year post delivery. So the other method, the other thing that needs to be there is you have to be fully or nearly fully breastfeeding. This is where that you are every day or every time of your day, you are with the baby and the child is regularly breastfeeding. It's not, and what I mean here is that it's not like those mothers who usually have the breast pump there. So you need to be breastfeeding the baby physically. So I hope I'm clear on that. And here it's having less than 6 months. You are less than 6 months after delivering a baby. So the lactational amenorrhea is a temporary method for family planning, and you need to find another method. Otherwise, you're going to get pregnant. So this one is used for a short period, and it usually helps preventing pregnancy. So as you can see, there is a lady there who is breastfeeding. So I'm going to talk about emergency contraception. Emergency contraception is a wide topic, and this is what most of the people know, but they don't know of some methods that are there apart from the pills that they are used to. So emergency contraception, and I'll say this, I want it to be clear. Emergency contraception is not a regular method of birth control, in that it's not supposed to be taken on a daily weekend, like most of the people misuse the drugs. It's supposed to be used at least twice in 1 year. And let me repeat that. It's supposed to be used at least twice in 1 year. Remember, it has hormones, and it usually alters your normal cycle. So it can be used. These are the points of emergency that it can be used. In case you had unprotected sex and you didn't have any prior birth control method or contraception, and if the birth control that you use has failed, this is something like if a condom broke, or in cases of rape, that's when it can be used. And every weekend cannot be an emergency, guys. So remember that. So this is something that people don't know. Copper IUD can be inserted in the body within 5 days of unprotected sex, and it usually works as an emergency contraception. And I'll say this, the copper metal in the IUD, it acts as a spermicide. When it gets when it is inserted in the uterus, it usually causes some chemical change and inflammation of the walls of the uterus. So these changes is the ones that usually makes this fertilization unfavorable, and also the sperms usually die. They cannot go into the fallopian tube. So there will be no implantation taking place when you're using the copper IUD. So remember, this one can be inserted up to 5 days of unprotected sex. So for emergency contraception pills, it can be taken up to 3 to 5 days, depending on the brand of unprotected sex. But the sooner you take the pill, the better it will work. The sooner, the better. If you take it late, there are chances that it may fail. So most of the people may access the emergency contraception over the counter, and they are usually also on affordable prices. So we are going to talk of the permanent contraception. So permanent contraception, these are methods that cannot be reversed. This is supposed to be done by a couple or people who have decided that they have enough kids, they don't need any more kids in the family. So we have two types. And remember, the permanent contraception is also called voluntary surgical contraception because it involves surgery. So we have two types. So we have female sterilization or tubal ligation. So tubal ligation is the closure, is the tying of tubes, the fallopian tubes. In a normal woman, you have two tubes. So it's called bilateral tube ligation. So if the woman can have their fallopian tubes tight or closed so that the sperm and egg cannot meet for fertilization. Remember that the place that fertilization occurs in a woman's body is in the fallopian tubes, and then it is implanted in the uterus. So if the fallopian tubes are tied, there will be no eggs meeting with the sperms, because when they are tied, the ovum cannot get to the tube so that can be fertilized, and also the sperm cannot get the ovum. So, but someone, when a person does this, they'll get their normal menstrual period. So it won't affect anything. So basically, this is a procedure that is done in a hospital, probably an outpatient in a theater. And you can go home in the same day, depending on how you are after the procedure. And you can resume to your normal duties within a few days. So maximum of a week, you are good to go. So the effectiveness is immediately, and the failure rate is 0.5%. That's a very low number. So we also have another method that is called a vasectomy. A vasectomy is done on the male partner. So this one is done to keep a man's sperm from getting to his penis, so that when he ejaculates, there is no sperm that can fertilize their eggs. Ejaculation takes place like normal, so nothing will be affected after this procedure. It's going to produce the semen, produce the seminal fluid, not the semen. So the seminal fluid will still be there, but there'll be no sperm after. At least 15 minutes, and when you're done, the man can resume to his normal duties and he can recover in less than a week. So most of the of this vasectomy done, there is a new version where they don't even, the bleeding is minimal, so it can be done, and you are good to go. So in most of the facility, we advise clients to come after 3 months post procedure, so that you can do a test called seminalysis to check if the sperms are still there. And when most of the people who are done the vasectomy, 3 months after the procedure, there are no sperms seen in the seminal fluid. So it can take up to 12 weeks, that is 3 months. And it can, it should be, so meanwhile, in men who are using vasectomy, so the 3 months grace period after the procedure is done, you need to use another family planning method to prevent your lady or your wife from getting pregnant. So the failure rate here is 0.15. So basically, I'm done with my presentation. So if anyone has any